Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Michael Levin, President and COO of Las Vegas Sands.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Before I turn this program over to Roger Gross of Global Gaming Business, I've been given the honor of introducing today's speaker. How does one introduce someone who needs no introduction? How do you introduce someone who has changed the lives of thousands of people, including my own? For nearly the last 6 years, I have helped execute Sheldon's visions by listening to his suggestions, corrections, and ideas, learning from his experience, while at the same time witnessing his brilliance. But today, I hope that all of you here will get a taste not only of some of that, but also a much better understanding of who Sheldon Adelson really is. Not just brains and ideas for business, but what he thinks about the world, his friends, his family, and his values. There are no tough questions you can ask Sheldon to answer. There is never a dodge of the bullet, never a doubt to an answer. He is always direct and absolutely confident in every answer. When you get to know him better, you will put your misconceptions, if there are any, and prejudicial pictures in the wastebasket, for you will see he is a patriot, a father, a grandfather, and most of all, a loyal friend. Sheldon Adelson is more than just a successful businessman. You will know that after you hear him today. Please listen. It will make your afternoon worthwhile. Ladies and gentlemen, my boss and my friend, Sheldon Adelson.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you for giving us this time today, Mr. Adelson. It's very nice to be able to do this, and I'm honored to be able to have chosen to be speaking with you today.
You could just call me, hey, you.
Can I first
acknowledge that there are a couple of important people
Absolutely,
here.
Please.
There's Andrea and Steve Wynn.
Absolutely.
That we've become very close friends.
My
and
boss,
most important, I've become very close friends with another person, my wife. We've been very good friends for 26 years now. And I expect another 26 years.
Absolutely, we hope so too.
If she takes me off probation. I noticed yesterday that Steve talked about he shut off his iPhone 6.
Yes.
Now, I can barely operate my Samsung 4. And prior to that, I couldn't operate whatever I had before. But I did console myself. I bought a new 4-engine, 22-hour range, A340-500.
Nope, very nice.
So I consoled myself, and maybe I don't have it, but it's used. It's not really new. But I did console myself with it.
Thank you. Well, I was honored to be at the interview you did with Artie Nathan at UNLV a few weeks ago, or actually a few months ago in the spring.
A few years ago.
And you told the story of your life, basically, the rags-to-riches story, selling newspapers on the corner, developing your many successful businesses, and finally the development of Comdex and your entry into the gaming industry. And I think we all know that story here in this room. Oh. We've all been admirers of yours for many years.
Well, tell me about it.
So I'd really like to start with the gaming part of your resume with our audience today. So if you could just start with telling us what inspired you to get into the gaming industry and the purchase of the Sands.
Say that again.
If you can tell us what inspired you to get into the gaming industry with your purchase of the Sands in 1988 and the subsequent construction of this facility.
Okay. Actually, at that time I was in the trade show business.
Right.
And I had a vision for creating a show I called Comdex, which was an acronym for Computer Dealers Expo. And I had It grew exponentially, so fast. It quadrupled from the first year to the second year, because the market for third-party distribution channel was exploding, and I sensed it was happening. And so I needed to find a piece of land, because I knew the convention authorities typically, not just Nevada or Las Vegas, but typically they work very slow, the municipal authorities. So I decided that I would go and buy a piece of land and build my own exhibition center. So that's what I did. I looked for a property. I had to get an adjacent facility on which I could build meeting rooms like what we're in.
Sure.
So right now we're in a box of meeting rooms that up to here is about 10, and we build 330 meeting rooms.
Okay.
So I needed a hotel that had enough land to build a million square foot convention center, which at that time turned out to be the largest convention center in the country. Mm-hmm. It was the first and only privately owned built. So I got into the business. So I had to buy the property, I had to get a gaming license,
right. Mm-hmm.
And everything that went along with it.
So it was more about...
Which is what I did. It was more about getting the land for the convention center.
It was more about the convention business than gaming at that point.
At that point.
Okay. And of course...
Well, I've sort of reversed myself since then.
Right. Of course, that was the first time the doubters came out of the closet. They said...
The
people who doubted you, who have
continued to doubt.
No,
that's not the first time.
Well, I'm talking about...
It's happened to me dozens of times in my life.
In gaming, let's leave
in,
it at that.
In anything. Okay. In everything.
But, you know...
That's why my wife still has me on probation.
They doubted whether this would work here. They doubted whether your entry into Asia would work. They've doubted almost every step you've taken along the way. Why do you believe that the people who doubt you were wrong, and how did you prove them wrong?
Why were they wrong? Because they guessed against me.
Right.
That should be clear. I'll have to go back a little bit in my lifetime. I've been in business for 69 years, since I was 12. And every time, after the first dozen or so businesses, I realized that the only way to get ahead was to do things differently than the way it was being done. And then I came to learn, which I finally learned at my ripe young age, that if you do things differently, success will follow you like your shadow. And you can't get rid of it. Mm-hmm. So that's what I did. So people doubted me because people just didn't do what I would do. It's a matter of finding out what it is that an industry does and identifying the opportunity as to how to do it differently, and then being enough of a risk taker to actually do it differently.
Mm-hmm.
So people doubted me because nobody thought of doing it the way that I did, and they were satisfied with the status quo, and I'm never satisfied with the status quo.
Okay. Well, let's talk about Asia. One of the things that happened in the beginning where the concessionaires were chosen, they all had some plans, but you had plans for a region in Macau called Cotai, which was just a marshland at that point. What did you see there that has now come into fruition today, where there's all these great facilities that are up and being constructed right now?
Well, if you looked at Las Vegas and you had a couple of big helicopters with big slings, and you put it under the strip, and you picked up the entire strip with all of the properties abutting it, and bring it over to Asia, could you succeed?
Mm-hmm.
And the answer to me was yes. I mean, Steve and Caesars had made a career out of bringing in Asians,
mm-hmm.
and they did very well at it. So it was clear that the Asian people loved to, as I call it, challenge luck.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was clear to me that if I just picked up Vegas, But I looked around, I couldn't find any big helicopters big enough to pick up the strip, so I decided that I'll just reproduce the strip the way it was built here over there. And that's what it's all about. When the government first gave me the piece of land, Macau is comprised of a peninsula, which is part of the mainland, and two very small islands, very short distance away. The peninsula connected to one, and the one had only a causeway connected to the second. And the rest of the land was all water. It was a bay and a swamp. And I thought it was ideal. It was flat. There were no hills. So I could reproduce what I saw as the strip. Flat, no hills. Mm-hmm. And all I had to do is, when the government sent me out there, I asked them, they said, well, this is going to be your permanent site. After they gave me what turned out to be the Sands Macau site. So I went out there and I looked at it and I said, and I couldn't find the land.
Right.
So I went back to the government and I said, I thought for sure I was being exiled. For sure. They didn't want a guy to come out there, and so I couldn't get in the middle of the peninsula where all the casinos were. There were only a couple. There were none in the second island, the first one in, there were two or three small ones in the first island.
Right.
So I went back to the government. I said, well, you sent me out to it, what was called COTAI, an acronym of Kalawane and Taipa. And I said, I didn't find the land. I said, where's the land? They said, it's under the water. I said, what am I supposed to do, take a pump and pump the water out or what? And they said, no, you bring in sand, you bring in barges of sand and you fill it in. I said, okay, I guess we can do that. Mm-hmm. My vision was to create Asia's Las Vegas, make a strip. Now, it wasn't long enough, it was only from one island to the other, it was only 2.5 kilometers. Mm-hmm. And we couldn't measure in miles because their cars were in kilometers. Right. They were metric cars. So I measured it by driving it. So what I met with an architectural land planning firm, and I laid out what turned out to be, because it wasn't long enough to equal this strip, 20 lots. On this strip, there's about 25 mega resorts. 20 would be enough. Mm-hmm. And so I laid it out, I gave it to the government. They thought it was great. Of course, everybody thought I would fail. Mm-hmm. I got into a pissing match with Stanley Ho about, he thought I was gonna fail, I thought he was gonna fail, that we were gonna put the peninsula out of business. It was gonna be like downtown Las Vegas compared to the strip. Blah, blah, blah. We went back and forth. And I told him, I said, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. So he put on an apron and he cooked pork and rice. And he gave out pork and rice to all his customers. It was a pretty funny scene. So I started the build. One of our competitors, the guy with whom we were originally supposed to share a license, Galaxy. The guy came up to me and he said, I ran into him one day while we were still talking. He doesn't want to talk to me anymore. And I said, well, when are you going to start? Because it's a whole long story, but we each got the same amount of land. There was 115 acres that we each got. And I picked the land on the strip and he picked the land in back of the strip. To the west of the strip. And I said, when are you going to start? I don't see any construction going on. We opened in 07, it must have been 06, I said to him. He said, oh, I'm not going to do that. He said, first of all, I don't think you're going to succeed. But I'm going to wait till you take the risk and see whether or not you do succeed. If by some chance you do, by some luck, you succeed, then I'm going to build. Mm-hmm. But if you don't succeed, I'm not going to build. I said, okay. So he lost 3 years, right. 4 years. And then he opened, that was Galaxy.
I remember the first time we came to the opening of the hotel there, the Venetian, and his building was halfway up, and he had stopped construction. So he was still waiting then, at that point, for you to succeed.
Even after he started.
Right.
After we opened and he started, he kept on stopping.
Right.
I'd say all in all, he lost probably about 4 or 5 years.
Okay. Well, let's talk about Macau today. We've run into a bump in the road revenue-wise. A lot of problems in the VIP junket area. What's happening? A lot of people have different views of that. From your viewpoint, what's happening there now?
Well, my view is that everything that I've seen happen in the last 13 years, when I first was exposed to Macau, is cyclical.
Mm-hmm.
It comes and it goes. It's like gambling. You start off at a baseline, sometimes you're up, sometimes you're down. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you're up, sometimes you're down. It's cyclical. Everything that happened there, for instance, when they limited the number of times somebody, a Chinese citizen, could go to Macau, first they said you can only go once a month and once every 2 months, then once every 3 months, but they never announced it.
Mm-hmm.
And they never announced that it was over.
Right.
This time, quite surprising to me, they announced within the last couple of days that they said that that they've achieved their goals in this corruption crackdown, and they're gonna let up on it.
Okay.
Surprised the heck out of me.
So you think we're at the end of this difficult period?
I think the players that want to stay below the radar,
mm-hmm.
that don't want to show up there, whether they're corrupt or not, they mm-hmm. just don't want to, you know, there's a lot of money involved and they don't want to send a message to the government that they may be corrupt.
Okay.
They don't want to be seen.
Okay, great.
So I think it'll take a couple more months before people feel a little more comfortable and they'll come and play more.
And people are still ignoring, however, that the mass market is growing very strongly in Macau.
Well, what irritates me a little bit is how people look only at the short term.
Mm-hmm.
When my friend Steve once said, I don't want to be judged on a quarter-to-quarter basis.
Right.
I mean, this is a long-term investment. And you can't judge. They're getting down to, they're talking about win in MOP per day for the last week.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty soon they're going to talk about MOP win or loss per hour.
Right.
Then they'll have a reader board up and it'll show how much is win or loss per minute. So this is all ridiculous. You know, you're in business for
the long term.
For the long term. Right. We've spent 9 or 10 or 11 billion dollars, but who's counting? And in Macau. And we're under construction with another property. And I've asked for permission to do yet another one, non-gaming,
mm-hmm.
without tables. I think that I didn't invest that kind of money just so that I could have the next week or 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
I invested that money over the long term. I don't think that the cultural practices, the cultural mores of Asian people is going to change. It's been happening for thousands of years. And I don't think it's going to change. And if the shortfall right now is cyclical, it'll come right back.
Okay.
I can't imagine, even if they didn't make the recent announcement, that it would last another 6 or 8 months.
Okay, great. Let's talk about Singapore.
The mass market is growing.
Mm-hmm.
The Chinese government has spent tens or hundreds of billions of dollars, U.S. equivalent, to build transportation infrastructure. And they're coming through with high-speed trains that are bringing, we've gone to the outer reaches of Guangdong province, to the narrow reaches of the adjacent province, and now we're penetrating those provinces with this very high-speed, very costly transportation infrastructure. Now, when the bridge gets finished in less than 24 months, the Hong Kong-Macau-Zhuhai Bridge. Macau, interestingly, will have another ready-made airport. which will be almost as fast to get in and out of Macau as it is with the Macau airport. Mm-hmm. So if you get out of the Hong Kong airport and you turn one way, 20 minutes you're in Macau. Mm-hmm. If you turn the other way, it's 45 minutes to drive downtown, usually through a little bit of traffic at least, to get to Hong Kong Island. So you got to ask yourself, do I want to go to Hong Kong Island, or can I just go to Macau and go to my convention, or go and have a good time with leisure tourism and gaming thrown in? So we are going to have another airport that services 100 commercial airlines, servicing 180 cities. We're servicing 50-some-odd million people in and out for a year. Mm-hmm. So with that and that additional infrastructure, that air transportation, the ground transportation, the government is, the PRC is spending hundreds of billions of dollars on, it's just going to reach further and further into the eastern part of China. And as we do, these people will come, knowing they can't come every Monday and Thursday. They'll come once in 3 months or 6 months or maybe once a year, but they're going to bring a much higher gaming budget with them. So this will feed into the premium mass and into the VIP markets.
And of course, the fact analysts still ignore is that we penetrated, Macau has penetrated only about 1% of the Chinese market so far.
I think the figure's a little over two. But that's if you consider that all of the visitation comes only once a year.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Now, we know that's not true.
Right. No question. Well, let's talk about Singapore. They call it an integrated resort there. You were one of the bidders. You won out. And the property you put out there...
I got lucky.
The property you put up there is simply spectacular. It's one of the most iconic buildings in the world. I remember being in Mike Levin's office the day they were raising the platform to the top. And he was a little bit nervous that day. But
I was there.
Yes, that's right.
I was going to sit on it, you know, like in the movie. The guy that sat on the bomb, right. And he rode the bomb all the way. I was gonna ride the bridge, the span, all the way up to the top.
Or maybe when Steve sat on top of his building in the beginning, right?
I was thinking about that the other day. I had to say, he must have had a hell of a nerve to do that.
So why did you build something
so
iconic?
It's a good thing his wife liked him. She could have either cut the rope or gave him a... Well, gave him a push.
Why did you build something so iconic? Why didn't you just recreate a Venetian in Singapore?
Well, the competition had an architectural component to it. Mm-hmm. They said that like 20 or 30% of the decision was going to be made on a architecture. Mm-hmm. But we had an architect, Moshe Safdie, that is brilliant. Mm-hmm. And does things somewhat iconic. And when he came up with that, actually the bridge on the top level, the Sky Park, mm-hmm. wasn't in his original idea.
Really?
No. But after we finished the design and I had to give final approval to it, I told him he didn't have a swimming pool. He said, well, tell you the truth, you don't really need a swimming pool. He said, besides, I don't have any place to put it. We used up all the land. I said, put it on the roof. Of course, there were hotels with swimming pools on the mm-hmm. roof. He said, oh, that's a good idea. Now, I didn't ask him to build the whole Sky Park. He said, but if you got three buildings, I said, well, maybe you can, if you take the top floor and we send elevators up the outside two buildings, put the pool in the middle, and they could walk over a pedestrian walkway between the buildings. I don't think he's going to build what he did. So he did that, and it turned out to be the best.
Okay.
And I do believe in iconic buildings, mm-hmm. that when we're competing with other people that have very good buildings, I saw the design in some publication of MGM's proposal for Osaka, mm-hmm. A beautiful design. Mm-hmm. Could it be considered iconic? To me, iconic is like the opera house in Sydney, Australia, where if you looked at the picture, you know exactly the city in which it's located. Mm-hmm. That's an iconic building. So all of our presentations for future locations and emerging markets will be iconic buildings. It's kind of like when architects, young architects, come out of school and they get a job at the architectural firm, and they, in their interview, but once they're accepted, the architect, the boy or girl, will take a design out of their back pocket or out of the girl's pocketbook and say, "Hey, boss, you know, I've been dreaming about this while I've been in architecture school. I want to show you the building that is going to be the greatest building that we could ever do here." And then he shows it to the boss. The boss looks around for the round file cabinet. And he takes it and he throws it over into the round cabinet. And he says, "Well, nobody's going to buy that. So, I mean, that's a beautiful building, but it's iconic. It's iconic. Only universities and museums can afford to build an iconic building. And only somebody as crazy and as risk-taking as Sheldon Adelson would build an iconic building for the billions of dollars it'll cost, because it wins the day." So it's one thing to compete with all the other hotels here in the Strip, and it's another thing to have an individual iconic building and offer this to an emerging market. Okay. And when I'm looking at the mayors and the governors and whoever I'm talking to in the government, I sort of hint, I said, "You know, your grandchildren will say to their cohorts in school, 'My daddy was the mayor and he's responsible for building that building.'" That's what your grandchildren will say.
Okay.
Haven't said that yet, but I expect them to.
Let's talk about this country for a few minutes. On the Las Vegas Strip, a large majority of its revenues now comes from the non-gaming amenities. Do you believe this is something that casino destinations all across the country should strive for now, particularly in view of the increasing competition in all the jurisdictions in the U.S.?
We should what?
I
was thinking about the answer before you finished the question, and I missed the question.
Should the casinos in the United States concentrate more on creating non-gaming amenities to attract non-gaming customers?
Yes.
And what amenities do you think
would work? It's clear. You've got to scale it down. We did this in Bethlehem.
Right.
We took an integrated resort business model, mm-hmm. and we scaled it down. Mm-hmm. It's scalable, but only to a certain extent, because these meeting rooms, if we're going to be a MICE-based marketing strategy, we've got to have so many square foot of meeting room to so many for each sleeping room.
Right.
So you got to build, you just can't say, "Well, I'm going to be in what's called in Asia, MICE, mm-hmm. right. meetings, incentives, conventions, and exhibitions." You can't say, "Well, I'm building a property that's going to specialize in MICE and build 10 meeting rooms." Mm-hmm. You know, I'm making a proposal for and I'm building 500 meeting rooms. Mm-hmm. When I came up with my idea that I couldn't finally get the Spanish government to agree to, I got one of the three governments in Spain to agree to it. But then the EU wouldn't have done it. Mm-hmm. I was going to build 2,400 meeting rooms. That would have been the convention capital of the world. Mm-hmm. But wherever we build anywhere else, just I believe in the MICE business.
Right. But there has to be a gaming component to support that,
that's
a building
right.
that large.
You lose money operating places like this. Mm-hmm. You can't pay back the money just running exhibition convention right. centers, like you know, making charging a little more in a hotel room. Mm-hmm. You got to have something to subsidize it. Okay. There are various parts of an integrated resort that will lose money, like the museums, like the arenas, like the exhibition centers, like the Congress Center, we mm-hmm. call this, that's a European term, Congress Center, meetings and ballrooms. Mm-hmm. You can't make money on that, but you need a subsidy to put up enough critical mass to make it what you're trying to make it. mice focused, or whatever you want to do, entertainment focused.
Okay. You declined to bid on a license in Massachusetts, and which some people found a little strange because you're a native of Massachusetts.
I still have a home there.
Exactly. Do you still think that was the right decision now, especially since it's taken so long to get the process underway, and we're still quite a ways before the first casino will open?
Well, I didn't think I could scale down. My business model of an IR, an integrated resort, works best in the middle of a city or on the edge of a city, because we need the other tourism infrastructure to support it. We need restaurants, we need other hotels, we need local transportation, we need national or international airports. There was no downtown location available in Boston at which my mice-based business model could work. And besides, I saw the possibility of New Hampshire opening up a couple more, Connecticut having a couple, Rhode Island having a couple, Maine having some, two or three, and New York was just, Massachusetts, only 125 miles wide. Mm. And I just saw that there were too much. So in order for my business model to work, I had to be downtown. There was no land available downtown to do this. And I thought that if there are already going to be as many as 10 or 12 casinos within 100 miles, my friend Steve does a better job at creating a mystique about establishing a new property. He does a better job than I do. We each have our own specialties. He's got a better specialty of getting the mystique about the property better than I do. I'd take a different approach. So he could do it better than we can. I'd have to scale down my mice-based business model, and I wouldn't have condos to sell in order to get back the money that we're spending on our core assets. So for those combination of reasons and the fact that we're looking for other larger in-city emerging markets, that we decided against going there. Okay. But there's 10 or 12 competitors. So the market, Steve will do much better than all the other properties, because they're just putting up plain casinos.
Right.
He'll put up more amenities, more of an integrated resort, and he'll do a comprehensive and a good job. Mm-hmm. What he needs to make money and what the community wants for the sole purpose of to accomplish the reason and the raison d'etre for establishing quote casinos in the first place, he'll accomplish. The other guys won't accomplish.
Okay. Another market you declined to enter was Atlantic City. Even when you got into the business in 1988, that was the only other gambling market in the country. Why did you not see any opportunities there then or now?
Because when I was a kid, my uncle had a wheel at the Million Dollar Pier, and I worked in Atlantic City. And I used to vacation there when I was stationed in New York City in the Army, in which I was located for 2 years. And I just got a feeling that everybody has to come to Atlantic City. There is no existing local market there. Even Steve got out of it many years ago after he just got in it. It was my conviction that one day the abutting states are going to legalize gaming and it'll suck out all the business that Atlantic City is siphoning from the adjacent states.
Okay, which has just proven itself out.
It's proven itself out.
Now, yesterday in northern New Jersey at the Meadowlands Racetrack, they had a conference and they were talking about building a facility in the Meadowlands. A lot of people brought your name up at the time, thinking that you're the only one that can come into the Meadowlands and build something spectacular enough that it would draw people from New York, Pennsylvania, Connecticut, and the whole tri-state region.
They did.
They did.
Oh.
Would you be interested in that?
Yes.
Yes. And you...
Do I have to explain that?
Well, can you... So it's proximity to New York with all the transportation options from New York City, from the northern New Jersey market, is attractive to you and your company then?
Yeah, because Secaucus doesn't have the pig farms that used to rain the odor of the pig farms on that part, on Meadowlands. And when I was stationed at Governor's Island in New York City, I could smell Secaucus on Governor's Island. So we don't have that anymore. So
right.
It would be a very attractive place to do.
Okay.
But it all depends what the government of New Jersey wants. Look, it's a two-edged sword. You could go in there and spend a lot of money, billions. And then you could wake up one day and then Governor Cuomo, whoever is governor or mayor of New York City, will say, look, they're taking all the New Yorkers' money and they're sucking it up in that casino in Meadowlands. We could open New York and keep the money in New York.
Mm-hmm.
So all the people that you're getting, you'll still have northern New Jersey and on the other side of the river. It's not a geographical distance, an equidistant from one place, one casino to another. It's a matter of travel time. So even though it may be 3 miles away, it could take you an hour to get there. And you can get there faster from 30 miles away and be there in 30 minutes, 35 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a matter of travel time, not the distance. Could it for at least 5 or 6 years provide a return on capital? Yes, and a good one.
Okay. Now,
so we would be interested in that.
Would you be interested only if it was a monopoly for your organization, or if there was a proposal for another one, say as there is in Jersey City, would that be something that would make you think twice?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I haven't thought about that. Nobody's brought that up to
okay.
me before, but I don't think I would have to think twice about it. If they put several, then I think twice about it.
Okay.
But if they put one other, I don't think so.
Okay. So do you think that the U.S. gaming market is completely saturated now, or is there room for expansion in some of the other areas of the United States?
There's only room for expansion in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly in South Florida,
mm-hmm.
or another casino in Tampa. Again, my model has to put me in a city.
Right.
I could scale down my model in part,
mm-hmm.
and still be successful out in a suburban area. Okay, like our property in Bethlehem is probably one of the most profitable EBITDA
mm-hmm.
line casinos of all the hundreds of casinos in local markets,
mm-hmm.
riverboats and land-based casinos and Indian casinos. It's probably one of the most profitable, if not the most profitable. But again, I'd rather be, it's very difficult to find good people to run large properties. You know, typically our property in another market or in Macau or Singapore would be minimum 3,000 rooms.
Mm-hmm.
But getting somebody who could be a GM of a 300-room property and then make that their life, and maybe they go to a 400 or 500-room property, it's completely different. The scale is totally different than what you need to run a 3,000 or 5,000-room property.
Okay. When we interviewed you around 2 years ago for a cover story, you told us about your opposition to online gaming. That was the first time you'd ever told a journalist that you were opposed to iGaming. But there's a lot of people that are saying that genie's already out of the bottle, that you can't put it back. Why are you continuing to oppose
that? That's a good sales pitch. They said a genie's out of a bottle, you can't put it back. Mm-hmm. Of course you can't put a genie back in the bottle, but it's not out of the bottle. First of all, look at when a state or a jurisdiction considers legalizing gaming. Take Massachusetts. Now, I'm born and raised in Massachusetts. I still have a home there. I'm going there tomorrow. And I still have relatives and friends there. How many years have they been talking about this? And what they've come up with is 3 casinos throughout the state. That's it. They didn't say, let's see, there's 6 million people. They didn't argue we're going to open 6 million casinos. But what are they doing? They're opening, if this was my cell phone, everybody's got a cell phone. Youngsters, underage, of age, for all intents and purposes, every single person. Even two of my grandchildren, one's 1.5 years old and the other one's 3.5 years old, they could take an iPad and they could hit the buttons on it to play the things they want to play. They can operate that better than I can. When something goes haywire and they lose the picture, they know what button to press to get the image back. I don't know how to do that. If I have to do it, I got to start all over from the beginning. It's not worth it for me to, I lose patience with that. And we're talking about a generation that if a state or the national government, first of all, this is not a state's rights issue, as the proponents would have us believe, because the internet is all over the country. It's in every home. There's no place that the internet doesn't exist, doesn't operate. So it's an over the state, cross border issue. This is not a state's rights issue. The argument that they make about, well, you could regulate it. I've talked to regulators here in this state, and I've said to them, tell me one regulation that we live by in the land-based gaming that you can enforce on internet gaming. They couldn't come up with one. I'll ask you, can you come up with one idea, one thing that they can enforce?
They can enforce the ID verification process.
But the ID verification process, it's like my 3.5 or 1.5 year old grandchildren, they get around anything. I have 2 teenagers, 15.5, 17.5. They can do anything on the computer. They could do wheelies, they could burn rubber on their iPhone. You mean to tell me that they can't get around it? What about my taking like this? I'm going to register. Here's all the buttons. Okay, am I registered? Okay, I can play now? Good. All right, here, son. What about that?
Well, that's entirely possible, but...
Not possible. It's likely. Look, how many kids... We have over $1 trillion of student debt. Mm-hmm. I know kids I was just inducted as an honorary brother in AEPI. And I've talked to a lot of the kids. All one kid has to do in college, of age, they say to the other, you know, I made $300 last night on a plane in poker. You think that they're not going to put peer pressure on somebody? What is the purpose of putting a casino in the hands of every single person in the United States?
But it's already in their hands.
No, it is not already in the hands. If the federal government would enforce the law, if we can reinstate the Wire Act and the government will enforce the law, the attorneys general have not enforced the law that they're supposed to enforce, that says that the foreign operators operate on the internet. Mm-hmm. All they have to do is close them down. They did it on a Black Friday several years ago. And by the way, one of the companies they picked up, PokerStars, that I think acquired Full Tilt, both of them were picked up as criminals. Mm-hmm. They settled with the government, and now they're trying to get back into New Jersey. Look, they're essentially lawbreakers. It's the same organization, just a different shareholder. So it's the same people that are doing it. They're, look, I come from a very poor family. The best you could say about the homes that we lived in that I call the slums is that it was a very crowded tenement. That's what we lived in. My parents were very poor. My father had a sixth grade education in Lithuania and left there at 12 years old, came to the States. He had no skill, no education. I think he learned the sixth grade in either Lithuanian or whatever language they spoke there. Could have been Russian, could have been Polish, I don't know. And he was poor, but he liked to gamble. He would go to Suffolk Downs with whatever spare money he had. He had to get a job as a cab driver. And he liked to go gamble. I can't say that my dad was addicted. I don't know, and I couldn't have assessed it at the time, nor can I look back now and say for sure that he was or wasn't. But I knew that he liked to gamble. He would go when he retired, they moved down to Florida. They'd go to the Hialeah or some track in the daytime. In the nighttime, they'd go to either Hialeah or the dogs. They would, with their friends, they would bet on any number they could find. The treasury numbers, the Irish sweepstakes, any kind of numbers they would find. And they would bet on it daily. I saw the cost of a family immersion into losing money on gaming. When you're on the internet, you cannot know your customer.
You do know your customer. You know your customer better on the internet than you do in person. You can have anybody walk up to the table here in this hotel and you're not going to card them and find out who they are.
I got to have a 12-year-old kid, 14-year-old kid could come up here and play.
Just
I wouldn't
just
be
as
in
well
business
they can
for a very long
internet.
Time. It would cut my business short. Mm-hmm. You cannot know your customer on the internet. Look, I'm the largest company by market cap by far in the industry. I think my market cap is equal to or exceeds that of all the other U.S. companies combined. If I saw that there was, to me, it's a matter of principle. I don't want it because I was raised in a family that suffered from the scourges of uncontrolled gaming. And I am absolutely certain, raising at my age two teenage kids, and I see how they easily get addicted to the, one boy plays all the games, my younger boy loves basketball and soccer, so he plays all these on television. You can't get away from it. My older boy loves to shoot, he takes weapons apart, does all the shooting programs on TV for hours. Somebody cannot tell me that kids aren't going to find their way around whatever voter, whatever user identification is. What is the compelling reason to put a casino in 318 million people's pockets? Is there a rationale?
Well, the rationale is that they're doing it already, and
no, no, that's
being,
not the
it's
rationale.
Being won by illegal
operations.
Well,
then why don't
operations?
We just why don't we legalize prostitution? Why don't we legalize cocaine and heroin? And all that? They're doing it anyway, so that's not a good reason to say, well, they're doing it anyway. So we gotta do it. Listen, my wife, of whom I'm exceedingly proud, is a physician. She started off as an internist and an emergency room doctor in her home country of Israel. She came here to this before I met her. She worked in the laboratory for the biology of addictive diseases in Rockefeller University, on which faculty she still sits. She set up three drug abuse treatment and research clinics. One is here in Las Vegas, one is in Israel, and one she set up in Macau. It's run by the health ministry. She didn't want to make it one of our clinics. or it's all nonprofit, mm-hmm. of course, and it's philanthropic. There's not one patient there that didn't start smoking marijuana. Mm-hmm. I lost a son from my first marriage to a drug overdose because he started with marijuana. To me, these issues of marijuana and internet gaming are principal societal issues. They shouldn't take place simply because they're doing it anyway. You want to legalize it? It's ridiculous. You could legalize all the vices that there are. And how can you say, Roger, that you can identify somebody? When I just gave you the example of somebody checking in and then giving the phone to an underage or an of-age kid, whatever, how can you say who's playing? There's no way you can do that. And any kid will get around this in a heartbeat. It won't take them long because these kids have grown up on these electronic devices. Okay. So there's no protection and there's no reason to do this. Why? Because one of our colleagues in the industry has a brand that they think is going to save their company. It isn't going to happen. First of all, it's going to take years to build up. Mm-hmm. Vis-a-vis what we see going on in Nevada, Delaware, and New Jersey. They took in several million dollars a month. Why, any one of us do that in minutes in one of our casinos, particularly those that Steve and I operate in Macau, and if Steve got into Singapore or one of the emerging markets there, you could do $10 million in business in 10 minutes.
Great.
So for the whole month, well, so far they've only, in the few months they've been open, I think 7 or 8 months, did what, $20 million gross in business? Some small amount.
Right.
I see no benefit, and coming from a family, the working class family, or less than working class people that are going to be exploited and going to be abused the most. I don't want those people to get abused, because when I look at people like that, I see the faces of my parents.
Right.
And I don't want those people to be abused or to be exploited. We can make money, we do very well, making money by having somebody come in. We know that they're not flying high. Mm-hmm. They could be very high, out of control of themselves. And what are they going to do with the poker players that are expert at playing poker? They're just going to clean everybody out, like they do in the poker clubs and mm-hmm. various casinos. Right. I just don't see that there is any compelling reason to put a casino, an electronic casino, in 318 million hands.
Great.
Why, should one or two companies can try to bail themselves out with that?
Right. Well, thank you for that. I wanted the audience to hear the passion that you bring to that subject, as I heard 2 years ago for the first time, and we just heard it now. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
We only have a few minutes left. I just have one more question left. You've had such an amazing life. You've got a lovely wife. I actually was in her clinic in Las Vegas and was amazed at the compassion she has for the people. You've got a loving family. You've had hundreds of successful businesses.
Dozens.
Oh, dozens of a litany
but
of success.
His business ends up with a few children.
What do you look at as your grand accomplishments in your life?
Besides what we do for our ethnic group,
right,
the Jewish people in the state of Israel, that's first priority.
Okay.
What I look at as my legacy in life is my medical research foundation that I've discovered. I've created a new way of requiring collaboration between scientists, and we have a very unique, what has been said, has fundamentally changed the way medical research is conducted. That will apply to every human being on Earth. We just took on, I found out that we study about 10 or 12 diseases, of which 6 or 7 are cancers. that liver cancer, which is very high prevalence in Asia, and not as much here in the States, nobody was studying it. So we just picked up liver cancer, we picked up pancreatic cancer, and I consider that a, besides what I do in the Jewish and Israeli world, which is very high priority for us, I consider the medical research a very high priority. Great. It's because it affects everybody in the world.
Great. Ladies and gentlemen, won't you please thank Adelson for helping us out tonight.
Do you want me to take any questions?
I don't think so, no.
Yeah? Okay. Thank you.